the important thing, I think, to recognize about resiliency and sea level rise is that it affects both our natural environment and our built environment. And each of them is going to require some very careful thought about how we proceed. In Marin County, you can see it there. It has the most shoreline of any of the Bay Area counties when you combine the coastal side and the bay side. So we have to be thinking about this on both our natural resource areas along our coast, which are predominantly retained in their natural habitat, and on our bay side, where we have about 11 square miles of developed community that are going to be at risk. One big problem, many efforts underway, and the point here is that there is a tremendous amount of interest in and work on sea level rise resiliency from the federal government down to the local community level. Many different partners. It's going to take that, and it's partly because the scale of this challenge, the fact that it's both scientific, cultural, economic, all of these various forces make it a very complex challenge that we're facing here, and it's going to take all of us. And one of the most challenging aspects of this is to bring all of these diverse perspectives, many of which have regulatory responsibilities, into alignment so that the things that we're working on, we are working on together and not at cross purposes. Too many times, as a public policy person, an elected official in the role that I play, we find competing interests within our own governments that are there to serve the same community. And sea level rise is really going to bring this to the forefront, how important it is. In many respects, I feel like the last decade or so, we've spent overcoming the climate change deniers. And the next decade is going to really have to focus on assessing and prioritizing what it is that we are going to do in response to this this evolution. So here's the next one, and you know, truckloads of funding are going to be needed. The point here, they're showing New Orleans, and that they're pouring money to fill the levee. The point I'm trying to make is that it is a very expensive challenge that we face for any of the infrastructure. Whether you move it back or try to protect it, it's going to cost one hell of a lot of money. And where is that money going to come from? And as I point out there, that in local governments, state governments are dealing with the fact that we have underinvested in our infrastructure. It's aging, just like California. And as a result, there are going to be significant competing interests for where our public dollars are invested. And sea level rise response is going to have to crowd it or fight its way into that crowded field. Most of us are dealing with affordability in coastal California right now. It's out of control. It's a crisis of the highest proportion. Trying to fund and maintain a diverse housing supply is enormous. Our health and our human needs of an aging population are pushing forward. And so the point here is really that we have to work overtime to find a way to fund and make the case for funding our sea level rise response. I do want to say that there is a value of the government grants that have been offered to date, whether it be from FEMA, NOAA, Coastal Conservancy, Coastal Commission. All of these grants are there to incentivize and reward and motivate local communities to step up and engage. And I think we'll hear from some speakers today who represent those communities who are at the forefront of that. But we could also point out communities that still have yet to take up the challenge and even begin to think about what is facing them. Adaptive is the operative word. This is a point I really want to make, is that unlike a route to the planet Mars that we're currently planning for, even that challenging assignment has you know, scientific and mathematical ways of deciding the route and then pursuing it. Sea level rise, it isn't going to be even as clear as that. It's going to be a very responsive, adaptive approach. We're going to have to look at site-specific situations. We're going to have to recognize and develop our sense of priorities. We're going to have to monitor the science. All of these things require us to be adaptive. That's been recognized. I'm quoting this, learn continuously, and that's what we will need to do, and that's what we are doing today. Safeguarding California, which is almost an ancient document now, created in 2014, that's the other thing. The knowledge base is moving rapidly, but even then they recognize that we would have to be flexible. And sort of stepping into my role as a California Coastal Commissioner, we have a thick document on guidance for sea level rise, but even that has to recognize that various communities are going to have to take up these challenges differently. And I do think that maybe I differ a little bit with Gary on the idea that the only solution ultimately is to step back. I think there are some places that we are probably going to want to make the investment to try to protect. And I'm not sure it's going to be San Francisco Airport, but that might be a starting point. There are also the shorelines of major cities. You didn't have the picture of the U-Wall that's now being proposed for New York City. So there will be places where communities will make at least a significant stand to try and protect their investments in community. But there will also be many areas where the right response is going to be to step back. And that is hard to do. And as a coastal commissioner, we just last week were moving a single family home in Southern California back 65 feet from all of its neighbors. And they're concerned about having to look at the sidewalls of their neighbors. But somebody said, you know, just wait a few years, you'll have a great panoramic view. And I think that they're right about that. So we must all be part of the solution. And this is something I really want to emphasize to all of you. We really need to engage the whole community because the choices we have to make are substantial. They involve significant trade-off decisions, priorities, and then, as I said, funding issues. Cultural issues, equity issues are built right into this. And so I've got a couple examples here that I'm pointing out from our own county. I'm really proud that the Game of Floods is an interactive game that we developed to work with our community. I brought along the game today. Perhaps we could roll it out to even just take a look at it over the lunch break or something like that. But what we did is we created this imaginary island that had the same challenges that many coastal communities are going to face. We engage community members in the discussion, get them thinking about what's important to them. We incorporate some limiting factors around the economic issues, and we listen closely to their creative ideas. But most importantly, we get them thinking about it. Just this week, we were notified that it was awarded the highest award of the American Planning Association, and we'll be picking up that award. It is open source, and we'd be happy to share it with any community that wants to use it as a tool in engaging the communities. To the right, you see a viewfinder with a gentleman looking out over a portion of our southern Marin coast near the Sausalito area. We called it the OWL Project. We got funding from the Federal Emergency Management Authority, FEMA, to develop this. When you look through the viewfinder, you're able to look at either what it was in the past or what it will be in the future. So you, even though you're looking out on a landscape, you have the ability to change the lens to see the future, to see the past. The idea of this is, again, to bring awareness to the challenge that communities are facing. And I think that any kind of tool that can be used to engage the public right now, since this is the time of our lives where we have to come to terms with what this means for us, can be useful. The beautiful picture at the bottom is someone from Save the Bay celebrating the passage of our Measure AA. I'm very pleased that Bay Area residents agreed. 9 Bay Area counties came together in June for the first time, a single vote for all 9 counties. We passed a $12 per year per parcel tax, raises about $25 million a year, and it's exclusively for the environmental side of restoration and sea level rise accommodation. And so we're beginning to fund the wetland restoration projects and other associated environmentally beneficial projects, and leaving the infrastructure challenges to other agencies, but I think it was a very good sign. And then my final point for today, or this brief discussion, would be it's important to be resilient. That's what we're here for in this conference. But it's also important to remember we need to keep reducing carbon emissions. That's another piece, another side of the challenge, is to not just try to figure out how to deal with something that's coming right at us, but how to slow it down or turn it around for the future generation. The things we're doing in Marin County, we were the first community in the state of California to take advantage of community choice aggregation. We've created a Marin Clean Energy, our own energy supply company that is doubled what PG&E is providing in terms of renewable energy portfolio, and continuing to work on that. All of us should be working on coming up with renewable energy proposals going forward. We also have, and what I'm showing you here is a dump truck releasing a load of fresh Marin County compost made from our green waste materials that are diverted from the landfills, along with our dairy and equestrian waste, to create compost that is spread at a very thin level across our pasture lands, improving the quality of the soil, the water retention characteristics of soil, but most importantly for this issue, sequestering carbon in a way that keeps it in the ground and helps to take it out of the atmosphere. So it's a combination of reduce our use of carbon, but also to take the carbon that's in the environment and store it in ways that it won't be counterproductive. I have been involved in transportation, and I think transportation in the Bay Area is 40% of our greenhouse gas emissions. So transportation has a huge role to play. Clean fuel vehicles, electric vehicles, we're moving aggressively in our county to build the infrastructure for that. And ultimately, I think that that what this nation and perhaps the world needs to really grasp onto is the idea that the carbon tax is going to be an important tool to change the way in which this world lives. And finally, I think that living more simply, consuming less, is also a part of that. Thank you.